Good news, we're back with another episode of Armchair Architects, the Azure Enablement series that's an ongoing conversation with Eric and Uli, two of the smartest architects I know. This episode, we're going to dig into something super interesting. We're going to talk about the relationship between simplicity and architecture. So join us. Hey, so welcome back to another episode of Armchair Architects as part of the Azure Enablement Show. So in the last topic, we were talking a little bit about how to become an architect. And the thing that kept on coming up for us was questions around simplicity and complexity. And I would really love to dive in with my colleagues here, Uli and Eric, into that question. So if you folks are up for it, I wanna start to dive into the role of simplicity in architecture. Because I suspect like it's really fun to toss off things like I'll make it as simple as possible, but no simpler, and like, you know, drop the mic and walk away. But I suspect there's more to it. So can we talk a little bit about like simplicity? Is that like your primary goal? Is that a secondary goal when you're designing architectures? Is that not a goal at all? Like what's the role of simplicity when you're architecting like you architect?
I think to me, it's more of a philosophy or a pervasive thread that you often have to revisit at every stage when you're asking, you know, as Uli said before, the why questions. If you're like me from an architecture perspective, you're visualizing the way that these solutions might fit together. And then you're asking yourself, whether it's in your brain or if it's on paper or in, you know, your favorite architecture diagramming tool, is this as simple as it needs to be? Or is it overly complex and can I reduce it further? Am I providing too many knobs and bells and whistles? Can I create a more coarse-grained API interface across my microservice architecture? And that way I can actually make it easier on the people that have to consume it. So to me, it's something that you visit and revisit critically all throughout the architect journey.
Yeah, and I would add to this, and David, you will appreciate this being an operations person. Simplicity is a question that you should ask from multiple dimensions. Eric mentioned the developer pieces in terms of technical debt, simplicity, coarse-grained access versus fine-grained access, and so forth. I also look at it, have the notion of what happens if stuff breaks at 3 a.m. in the morning and the developer isn't available to debug the code. So how do you tell an operations person how to deal with the system? And the more complex the system is, the more hard it is to effectively go and bring it back online or make sure that the customers can successfully complete the operations. And so for me, simplicity also has to do with, okay, stuff breaks, what happens? And then the last piece of that, which goes in the similar vein, is if I have to update the solution, how do I do this? How many things do I have to touch to update the capabilities that I'm building out? And the more things I have to touch, the more complex it is. And therefore, the likelihood of failure is much higher than if I keep it simple.
I remember one of my favorite talks was given by Casey Rosenthal, in which he was discussing the notion of necessary complexity. He's saying like, okay, cool. I build something and it runs on my laptop. That's cool, but that's not really what you need. You need to put it on somewhere else. And really, if you want to make sure that it doesn't fall over, you want two of them. And so like making redundancy has a necessary complexity cost to it. Whereas, you know, like you'd like it simpler, but like we all agree that like two of them is better than one. But I also have not met an architect who doesn't recognize that, you know, going from one to two is a really big leap sometimes when it comes to architectures, or, you know, it's not, or one to five is even bigger, you know, but the one to two jump. So, is there a way of, because the thing that's tricky about this is what you were talking about when you were talking about features. The thing that's tricky here is it possible to retain simplicity even though the incentives are to add features? Like, how do you do that?
I think it's a scale or a spectrum, almost an imaginary slider, right? And in one way, if you slide it into the more, I'll call it the fine-grained approach, right? Higher technical complexity, but more control for consumers of that particular service or application over capability. If you slide it the other way, you get probably a much better user experience that's more tightly integrated, but you give up some of that exposed control capabilities and things that many developers might want. So if you're an ISV, you probably do want to think about what your API surface is going to look like for consumers of that particular service. Also, I would advise that you have to think about the way in which your consumers, your customers, or your organization will consume your components. Think about what kind of code they will have to write that you're forcing them to write based on the API surface and of the solution architecture that you're building versus the code that they want to write. In other words, is your API a delight to consume, or is it really tough because you have to spend a ton of time stitching together solution components utilizing surgical code that make the integration really difficult and not consumable?
What do you mean by surgical code? I just want to stop you right there. What does surgical code mean? I've not heard that term before.
To me, a surgical code is any type of integration between components that require a significant amount of wiring up of those components so that they can talk to each other. So everything related to identity and access management, to coarse-grained or fine-grained API surface capabilities. The more powerful, I guess, an individual component's API is, the more you're going to have to do to get that API to talk to another API or talk to your service.
So I guess, but I'm still kind of stuck on this notion that says everybody wants more features. Everybody wants it, you know, and the next revision to have whatever in it that it didn't have prior, right? Like very seldom are people like, done, everything's cool. So how do you deal with the not done and yet not more complex every step of the way? Because otherwise the world, it seems to imply that the world tends towards complexity. And is that true? Is that like an existential truth that I should just get over right now?
More functionality does not automatically mean more complexity.
Okay.
It means more surface area potentially from an API perspective, like Eric talked about. But if you are providing a consistent model, so let's define what is an API these days. So on the one side, you have a REST interface that most likely follows open API standards from a shape perspective and exposure perspective, what used to be called Swagger, mm-hmm. although that's now called open API. Mm-hmm. And that's certainly one API surface that you want to think about. And again, more APIs means a little bit more complexity, but because the API follows a certain standard, open API, it's fairly straightforward. So as a user of this API, I will be able to go and say, oh, okay, that's another capability that I have that these guys now provide. But because it's the same API shape, it's fairly straightforward. The second type of API that's becoming, I think, a standard as well, is event-based exposure. So you effectively have a reactive, which is the REST-based API, and a proactive or observable API, where the system raises an API call through technologies like Azure Event Grid or similar. And effectively, somebody then says, I'm interested in that event. And again, that's just more event surface, but the consumption is structured and simple. So from that perspective, yes, it's more complicated because it's richer, but it's not more complicated because the consumption is straightforward and easy. If you would say, hey, I have APIs, I have a event, and the APIs have different shapes, not different shapes, but different structured. So you would use, let's say, instead of REST-based APIs only, you also throw in some older technologies like SOAP. And you throw some other stuff in where instead of you using consistently JSON and those kind of things, you throw in, oh yeah, this has XML, this has JSON, this is a CVS file, then it gets complicated. So for me, consistency is one part of the art of simplicity.
I'm thinking back to our last discussion, which we were talking about how to become an architect, and it made me think about how we talk about simplicity and complexity. Obviously, it's not binary, right? This is not either simple or complex. But do we have the right words? Like when you walk into a room and you want to tell somebody, gosh, that seems kind of complex. Do we have any terms or ways of talking about this is more or less complex besides more or less complex? Are there ways to say that in a slightly less subjective manner? When we say how complex is, how do you describe complexity is what I'm asking.
So one thing that we are really pushing hard on right now in the Azure world is concept count. How many concept count? So how many concepts do you as a person that's participating in the technology or is trying to use the technology have to understand in order for you to use it? If the concept count goes over 5, most people are opting out because it's too complicated. Ideally, you have one major concept, maybe 2 or 3, but that's about it. And most people just don't have the patience or the time to really understand 5 or more concepts in a single solution. And for me, complexity is almost linear with concepts counts. So you effectively, how many concepts do you have in that solution? If it's too much, it's getting too hard.
What's an example of a concept? I want to hear what you have to say, Eric, but I just want to make sure that I'm clear on what's an example of a concept.
I already talked about 2 concepts. So on the one side, you have an API, and the other side, you have an event.
I see. Okay, great.
Those kind of things. Those are concepts. But then you throw in, let's say if you are like Eric in the IoT world, you throw in, okay, there's a device that you have to think about. And that's a necessary concept and an important concept in IoT. But now you have 3. Okay, that's still okay. But how many more can you add before the solution gets too complex for people to really grasp and put their head around and use it consistently, which is really what you want? And so for me, concept count below 5 is an important simplicity element.
The term I've heard used is cognitive load. But I'm concept count sounds really cool as well. It looks like you wanted to say something, Eric, and I cut you off because I just wanted to get some clarity.
No, these are all great points. I think the couple of random thoughts that I think really apply here are, like, I think of architecture like fractions. Your goal is to reduce them to the lowest common denominator. So whether it's in terms of looking at it in terms of concept counts, or it's that's, you know, going back to that nagging feeling of, is this simple enough? The way to do this, I think, to justify it as well, is that you can't just go out and say, this is my simple architecture, I've solved it, stamp it, and it's done. In many instances, you have to actually show other architects that you've completed the thought. And so in many cases, you'll actually have to be like, well, I considered this approach and these other approaches and these components, but I rejected them based on these concepts. And the rejection is that I deliberately chose not to engage with these other alternatives because I was focused on simplicity or integration design, or maybe I went more complex, but there was a really good reason why I did that. The other thing I'll say is we oftentimes as architects begin to think that we're the only person around that can solve this problem. And as a result, we have to create something new. Even things that I've created before, I don't want to, you know, this is new, this is fun, this is something I can create. Reusing things is the hallmark of a great architect. Looking around and saying what's been done, whether it's the well-architected framework on our side or others, or something that you've done or a colleague of yours have done, beginning the conversation with what patterns, what paradigms, what architectures exist that I can reuse before I invent, I think is something that's important.
Yeah, and that's a really important point, Eric, because there's another dimension on simplicity versus complexity. We always assume that solutions get built and then it's done. That is obviously not true. We have solutions that are running on mainframes since 30 years, and they still get maintained. They get updated. You have code bases on Windows that are 20 years old, and they get updated. And so being able to update a solution, not just from a components perspective that you depend on, but your own code, requires you to also be not necessarily simple, but keep it as simple as you possibly can, because you might not be around to explain what was going on. Right. You might have moved on from the company or the solution. And so some other person has to now go in and understand, oh, this is what this person meant when he designed or she designed this capability and so forth. So for me, operational perspective and maintenance perspectives are something that are often overlooked by people that just design and build solutions, because sometimes they're not around when things go haywire or if things have to be move forward with new capability and so forth. So for me, that's another set of aspects I would throw into this conversation.
Well, this is one of the reasons why I initially had some questions about the term well-architected framework, because often when you think of architected, you think, oh, I hired an architect, they told me how to build the thing, and you know, they designed the thing, they built it, and then they walked away, because you don't have the architect knocking at your door going, hey, would you like to architect some more? And the conclusion I came to is that the key thing is staying in a well-architected state. Right. And that's one of the things that architects can do, is they can keep you in that state, because for very many reasons that we won't go into for this particular one, you can drop out of that state of feeling well architected. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to me to hear you discuss architects' role, not only as building things, but also like they might walk into a room and help you simplify what you're seeing on the whiteboard that already exists. And that sounds really cool. One of the things that Uli said a moment ago was about operations, and was this question about trying to keep things running, which segues us nicely into something else that I know we want to talk about, which is what to do in the situations where you've got architectures and applications and services that have to be running all the time. And that's a really tricky question. As per usual, I have to ask you to don't you think we should talk about that? Should we do that next?
I do.
I think that's a great idea.
Cool. Well, then with that, I want to thank all of you for watching this. I'm hoping you'll join us for the next episode, which now you know what it's going to be about, with the Armchair Architects as part of the Azure Enablement Show.